Today I've come to Cawdor Castle. Now, Cawdor Castle is approximately 6 miles east of Inverness, and it's not that far from the small town of Nairn, which is on the shore of the Moray Firth. Now, if the name Cawdor seems familiar, it's probably because you may well have read some of William Shakespeare's writing. And thanks to Shakespeare and his tragedy about the great Scottish general, Macbeth, the two names have forever been linked. In the first act, Macbeth comes upon witches who prophesy that he will, first of all, become the Thane of Cawdor, effectively the rank of Lord, and then later he'll become the King of Scotland. But to do so, at his wife's instigation, he will need to kill King Duncan. However, this is all fictionalised by Shakespeare, as the castle didn't exist in the 11th century at the time of Macbeth. Now, some parts of the castle tower house can be traced back to the mid-15th century. Other parts of the stonework can probably be traced even further back to the 14th century. But it was William Calder, the 6th Thane of Cawdor, who was permitted to build his tower house here in 1454. There's a legend that the location for the castle was chosen by William thanks to a dream that he had, and in this dream a donkey laden down with gold was allowed to roam around the countryside, and when it eventually lay down to rest, it lay down by a tree, and that was the location chosen to build the castle. Now, in the dungeon of the castle are the remains of the alleged tree. Carbon dating of the remnants of the tree suggests that the tree died sometime around about 1372, which gives added credence to the tower house was possibly built in the early period of the 14th century. Much of what we'll see today was built in subsequent centuries and was thanks mainly to the Clan Campbell, who took ownership in the early 1500s. Now, the castle is a fine example of different styles of architecture from different periods, and the castle gardens are simply stunning. So, let's head on in and take a look.
Now, if there's one thing that I can recommend, apart from coming to see this wonderful castle, make sure you buy the guidebook. It's actually two guidebooks in one. The main guidebook with the tartan cover gives a great in-depth history of both the castle and the families that have lived here, much of it with a great sense of humour. But the added bonus is the second guidebook, which provides the visitor with a room-by-room description and a little background of some of the items in each. They really are such great value. Now, as you walk round from the visitor reception kiosk along the drive, the castle comes into view. To the front is a wonderfully manicured lawn, which allows you to take photographs across the whole breadth of the castle and helps you to see just what a magnificent building it is. The drawbridge leads the visitor underneath the archway, with the Campbells of Cawdor motto clearly displayed as "Be mindful." Once through the archway, you'll find yourself standing in the courtyard entrance with the tower house directly to your front. And as you look around the courtyard, you become more aware of the different stonework for different parts of the building, which clearly shows that different parts were built in different periods. Then your attention is drawn to the coat of arms. This is the coat of arms of both Sir Hugh Campbell and Lady Henrietta Stuart. The left-hand side shows his half with Lady Henrietta's on the right and their respective initials at the bottom. The date, 1672, was the year that all coats of arms had to be officially registered for final approval by the Lion King of Arms. He was the chief herald of Scotland. And as you enter through the entrance, on the left is this small room with a cauldron, which could be a playful dig at the witches in Shakespeare's Macbeth. As I said earlier, there's a fantastic guidebook with room notes that you can refer to as you walk around the interior. There are also information boards in each room. This is called the tapestry bedroom for obvious reasons. The bed has had various parts replaced, but the headboard is original, and the Flemish tapestries, they were purchased in 1682. The yellow room is actually a beautifully comfortable looking sitting room. The room itself, as the guidebook tells you, is not entirely square, and the fireplace is off-centre, but it has a wonderful charm to it. Before heading to the next room, you will pass the tartan passage. And this next room is the pink bedroom, and at one time it was used as the withdrawing room, which would be where the women would withdraw to after dinner, while the men continued with their drinking and smoking. The Countess of Cawdor plays a very hands-on role in the running of the castle. During the off-season, she lives in the castle, and during the tour season, she lives in a nearby cottage. But on most of the days, she comes into the castle to see the staff and personally replaces the flower decorations in the various rooms. Again, we have another view of the tartan passage, but this time from the other end. The next room that you come to is the tower room, which is actually a feast for the eyes, with tapestries, paintings, cabinets, desks and sofas, But the most interesting piece is the 18th century nobleman's blue gondola seat seen here in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. This is the Thorn Tree Room. The legend claims that the then Thane of Cawdor chose this location to build his tower house because the donkey carrying the gold lay down by this tree, and it's carbon dated back to 1372. Now, the last part of the interior of the castle that we come to is the castle kitchen, with its wide variety of cooking utensils that would have been continuously used throughout the day to feed not just the owners of the castle, but also those who worked in the castle. Now, the second half of the video takes you around the castle gardens, which are simply splendid, so it's well worth watching to the end to see what a labour of love the gardens are. Here we're driving down the main driveway that takes you into the car park area, and this is the walkway round to the castle from the reception centre. So carry on watching this just to see what has been done in the gardens, because it truly is splendid. And remember, if you've enjoyed the video, remember to like and share it. And if you want to see other videos that we post on here, remember to subscribe on the red button in the bottom right-hand corner. Thanks for watching.